That success in multifoods was noticed by other people in other areas, and it wasn't long I got a call from Bob Hess, who was a biologist for the Michigan State Department of Natural Resources. They wanted to release peregrines in Michigan. We soon had John Castrale in Indiana, who turned out to be a very key player in this whole work, and then at Ohio and Iowa, Nebraska, over the course of the next several years, all joined in this thing.
Almost all the states in the Midwest were participating in this project. We became involved in the early 1990s. We made our first releases in 91, and subsequently we released 60 birds over a four-year period in urban areas of Indiana.
This continued from about late 1980s through about 1995 or 1996. And by that time, we had peregrine falcon releases going on in 9 states, I believe it was, and released close to 1,000 falcons. The birds, they had high rate of fledging success, a high rate of return for nesting, and in pretty short order, we had a self-sustaining peregrine falcon population such that it was removed from the endangered species list.
And so for a species to go on the list in the early 70s and come off the list within 30 years is unheard of. So we definitely have more peregrines now than we did 100 years ago.
Probably half or more than half of the birds are in urban areas, are using buildings for nest sites.
The really big story that came from all of this is that once these urban sites became quite saturated with falcons and there was no more room, then they started looking at these cliffs on the Mississippi River. And then from there, it just expanded.
Peregrine falcon restoration and the techniques that were used in trying to reestablish these populations have been adapted and used with other species. Bald eagles, California condors, opal-mottled falcons, directly as a result of the techniques worked out by Tom Cade and the Peregrine Fund and his successors.
Well, I think that the overarching lesson in all this is we don't have to be fatalistic about these things. It's within our power, by mobilizing the resources and making the decisions that need to be made, that we can alter the course of things here.
There was something that Bob always said that was absolutely important to him. He would say, we can make a difference. One of the things that was really important to him, he saw a lot of messages of doom and gloom, and he would say, you know, what use are those? They discourage people. They make people unhappy. What we really need to understand is that we can make a difference, we will make a difference, we have to make a difference. It was all about making a difference, and he thought we can, and I think we can.